Cool. All right. My name is Stephen Parkinson. I am the president of White Hat. And my talk tonight will be a little bit of an intro to SSH. And then we're going to go through an activity where we will set up an SSH key so that you don't have to use your password when logging into the Unix servers. So first, a little overview of the talk. What is SSH? Some configs. That will be specifically server because we're going to go through the client together later. And then we're going to go through how keys are managed, and then we'll do the activity. So first of all, what is SSH? It stands for Secure Shell, and it's essentially a protocol for operating network services securely over an untrusted network. The untrusted network in most cases will be the internet. And it replaced stuff like rlogin, rsh, and rexec, which didn't use much security at all because they sent their passwords in plain text. So anyone sitting on the network could just sniff the traffic and get those passwords. SSH is a little bit better than that. So as I said, it's typically used for remote command line. It can also be used for tunneling, for forwarding ports, and it can actually even forward. It can even forward X11 sessions. So basically, you can forward Windows, not Windows. You can forward an X session, which is like the window manager that most or a lot of Linux uses. Anyway, it can also be used for transferring files. So there's the SSH file transfer protocol, or SFTP. It is typically run on port 22. You theoretically could use any port you want, but that's the one that it defaults to. And it is actually included in most operating systems, including macOS, basically all Linux distributions, and as of Windows 17.09, so about 3 years ago, they have included it in there as well. So that's pretty cool. So yeah, a little bit of history for SSH. In 1995 was the release of SSH 1. And it was obviously, like I was saying earlier, designed to provide stronger authentication and confidentiality than things like RSH were. So I think the first place to start was to not send your passwords in plain text. And SSH did that. And it gained some popularity. And by the end of 1995, around 20,000 people were using it. And then by 2000, roughly 2 million people were using it. And then in 2006, SSH2 was released, and it is incompatible with SSH1. And included some nice improvements to the protocol, including the Diffie-Hellman key exchange. It also added some integrity checking with message authentication codes, making it harder for someone who is in the middle of a connection to modify the data that is transferring between the two computers. Basically just improving potential or improving resistance to man in the middle style attacks. And then there's kind of a fun thing with version 1.99, because that is the version that a server returns if it is compatible with both SSH 1 and 2. So I just thought that was a fun little thing. And then lastly, we have OpenSSH, which is widely used. it's the default in pretty much everything at this point, including Windows. So that was developed in 1999 as a fork of 1.2.12 of the original SSH, because I believe that was the last version that was open source. And then as of version 7.6 of OpenSSH, they removed all of the all of the SSH 1 backwards compatibility. So if you have anything above 7.6, there's no more SSH 1 in there. And yeah, that's macOS 11, Big Sur, which for some reason still has the same version as Catalina. But anyway, yeah, it's running 8.1. The version that you can get from Homebrew is 8.4. I just have not installed that. So yeah. Yeah, so a little bit of server config. There's not too much fun stuff you can do in here. It's stored in etc ssh sshd config. Permit root login is probably one of the things that you should disable if it is enabled. Basically what it disallows is logging in as root. Kind of self-explanatory, you know, the name makes sense. Yeah, so basically it has three options. You can either do yes, no, or prohibit password. Yes, meaning you allow root login. No, meaning you are not allowing root login over SSH at all. And then prohibit password, meaning you cannot use your password to connect. You would have to use an SSH key to connect to or to connect as root. And then, yeah, you have port, like I said earlier, 22 is the default. You can run it on any port that you want to, though. At one point, I had more than one machine on my network that was using SSH, and I wanted that outside of my network. So I think I started using 404 for one of the connections because I can't use 22 twice, so why not?
You could set the external port to forward to 22 internally.
That is actually what I did.
I had the same problem.
So. Yeah. Yeah, so it was still running on port 22 on my local computer, but to the outside world, it looked like it was running on port 404. And then, yeah, lastly, message of the day. This is just kind of fun if you have control over an SSH server, you can make it print out anything when someone logs in. It'll just print out whatever's in the etc MOTD file. So I think you could have some fun with that. Yeah, so then we're going to go on to key management now. This is from the server side. So when you connect to an SSH server, and you authenticate properly, it will, and you're using an SSH key, it will store that SSH key in a file called authorized keys. And as you can see in the screenshot, that is the authorized keys file from my EC2 instance that is running the Bungie server, which connects to my house. It's a Minecraft server. It's the white hat one, because I didn't want to give people my house's IP. Anyway, yeah, so basically it just stores the public key that your local machine gave the server when you connected to it. And then, yeah, of course, you can also use password-based authentication. In that scenario, it does potentially allow for some kind of man-in-the-middle attack because, or makes it more likely. But also, if the two computers have talked before and they're using SSH keys, man in the middling SSHs, it gets a lot harder if the two computers have seen each other before. Yeah, so if the computers have seen each other before, the local computer will store the host in the known host's file. That is the known hosts from my personal laptop. It's a lot longer than that. I have SSH'd into a lot of things. Yeah, I don't think there's anything interesting in there. If there is, I probably should have looked through it, but it's fine. Yeah, so basically what this prevents, or like when you connect to a server, it sends its public key to you, and then your computer stores it in this file so that next time you connect to the server, you can make sure that it is the same server that you were talking to before. That's basically all it does. It's essentially trying to limit the potential for some kind of man-in-the-middle attack. Yeah, so what if you have a server that you haven't connected to before and you want to verify that it is the server that you want to be talking to? Most of the time, you're just going to type yes in the little prompt and it'll be fine. But if you really, really do care, as SSH.com says, if your work requires the strictest degree of absolute security and you cannot trust the network that was used to deliver the host key, you can ask the system administrator of the remote host computer to deliver the host's public key to you personally, for example, on a diskette. So yeah, if you want to actually verify that it is the, when you're initially connecting to the server, if you want to verify that it actually is the server, you would have to obtain the public key from whoever is the admin of that server to verify that it matches the one that the server is giving you at the time that you connect to it. I would hope they have a better way of distributing them than floppy disks, but yeah, as the meme text says, if you ever find yourself in this position, I have a floppy disk reader, so hit me up. So what do the keys look like? Basically, it's just a bunch of random stuff, which is good. So the private key is the really long one, and the public key is the other one. Basically, the private key tells you I forgot the words. It tells you where it comes from also at the end there, that smparkin@wheatley.local. That is the name of my laptop, which will be doing some screen sharing in a bit. So hopefully that live portion works, but we'll find out. So what's important about these keys? The private key should not leave your local machine. It should never be stored anywhere other than the machine that you are using to SSH, you have a machine that you're using to SSH into another machine. It should stay on the first one. It should never go to the server. The public key can be shared with whoever you want. It can be put on servers and stuff like that. That's totally fine. Keep the private key private. That private key there, I generated exclusively for this slide. I deleted it immediately after. I don't even have it anymore. Like, keep them safe. Don't put your private keys on the Unix servers. That would be a bad idea. You can also set up GitHub to accept SSH, which is pretty cool. Basically, you just give them your public key, and then you can do all of the Git things. after that. Yes, yeah, so now we are on to the activity. I dropped my thirds. Okay, so this is going to be interesting because I am switching computers. Okay. So the first thing that you're going to want to do when you're creating an SSH key is generate the key. So we do that with SSH. Ooh, I should make this bigger. Okay. I had to do some window management. SSH keygen-t-RSA-B4096. And that's just telling it what to use and then how many bits to use. 4096 is actually, I believe 2048 is the default. 4096 is just theoretically more secure. So what might as well use it. So after you do that, it'll generate the key, ask you where you want to save it. Default is IDRSA, and because I know there are no SSH keys on this machine already, I'm just going to go with the default. Then you can enter a passphrase if you would like. Personally, I do not, but it is good practice to have a passphrase on your SSH keys because anyone who is able to obtain access to your computer would then be able to use the key without any kind of authentication. So for this example, I am going to enter a password. So now you can see it finished up and it now exists in the .ssh folder. So IDRSA and IDRSA.pub, the .pub being the public key. The next thing we're going to want to do to get the Unix server set up is set up the config file. So I don't have a config on this machine yet. We're just going to do this manually. So we're going to do host unix star host name %h.csc.calpoly.edu. The percent %h there will just take whatever is after the, or anything that comes after Unix, so the where the star is, and it'll put the Unix and then the whatever is after it where the percent %h is. So in our case, it's just going to be Unix 1, 2, 3, 4, something like that. And then we do user smparkin. If your username on your computer is the same as the one on the Cal Poly servers, theoretically you don't have to put user there, but so yeah, mine would work basically because mine's the same, but we're gonna put it there for fun. And then it defaults to using IDRSA as the key file. But if you did have multiple keys and you wanted to use a different one for a different server, you can tell it which one to use with identity file. In this case, we're just going to use IDRSA. And that is theoretically all you need in your config file. And the last thing that we need to do when setting this up is copy our key to the server. So for that, we can use SSH copy ID. You can also specify which key to copy in here. So we're going to use .ssh ID RSA. And then now that we have already set up, yes, I can actually do that now if we want a message. Was this the file that you were talking about, or the line? I'm going to assume yes. So again, the config file is basically just the host, what you want to type in when you're trying to access this server, the host name, its full name, basically what you would use if you didn't have a config file or a config setup for it, the user, and then the identity file. So now that we have the SSH all configured, or that we have the config file all done, we can use SSH copy ID dash I SSH ID RSA. And then we can, that's not how you spell Unix. We can use that to copy the file to Unix 1. And it gives me the prompt with the Unix servers key fingerprint. I'm just going to say yes because I don't really have a way to verify that it is actually that right now. So we're just going to trust it. And then it'll ask for your password one last time. And I am blanking. I got it. Messed up. And it should copy it over to the server. And as you can see there, it says try logging into the machine with SSH Unix 1. So now if we do SSH Unix 1, it'll prompt for the passphrase. Oh, shoot. I hope I didn't forget that. Okay, there we go. Oh, God, that would have been embarrassing. So now you can access the Unix servers without using your Cal Poly password, because it now can verify that it is you using the key that you gave it. Yes, that is the end of our live demo / activity. So that's about it for SSH. There's some other uses as well. Like I mentioned earlier, file transfer, you can use your SSH key with SCP, SFTP, or rsync as well. Rsync is pretty cool because it will only copy over the new data. So it's a lot more efficient than something like SCP or SFTP. There's also SSHFS, which basically will let you mount a remote folder locally, so you can browse it on your local machine. That's been useful many times in the past. So, theoretically, rsync can be used. Well, not theoretically, it can be used to secure any network service, although that requires more configuration than we're going to get into tonight. So yeah, that is about it. Are there any questions? Also, that's my new pup. Or I guess my parents' new dog. But yeah, he's real cute.
I have a question.
Sure.
Sorry if I'm asking you to repeat yourself, but what could you like clarify what the purpose of the config file is for SSH?
Yeah. Basically the config file is a way to shorten the name that you're using to access something. The EC2 host that I have, it has a really long host name that I don't want to type every time. So what I have done in the config file basically is just set up essentially a shortcut where I can just type SSH EC2 and then it will drop me into the shell on my EC2 instance rather than having to type out that whole EC2-34-211, all of that stuff.
Okay, awesome. Thank you.
Mm-hmm.